Hi, it's Sean, the Silver Fox. And in this video, I'm gonna go through the contents of the improvised possibles pouch that myself and Chris Grant were talking about, and then start to show you some of the items we were making whilst out on a hike in Scotland. So now I'm back in the UK, and unfortunately over that few days we was out, we just ran out of time. Now I've done a video before on the contents of a possibles pouch, and in that video I did state that, you know, I'm not a survivalist, and it's not the sort of thing, I don't normally sort of carry a survival type kit with me. Where I am, pretty much, I'm never that far away that I can't get myself out of trouble if I need to. But with that said, there's also an awful lot of stuff that you can improvise whilst out in the woods or out in the wilds, from using natural materials through to discarded litter, to pretty much cover every aspect you would require from a possibles pouch. So although this isn't going to be a complete an entire definitive list of a possibles pouch, it's going to go through and give you an idea of some of the things that you can pick up on the way and improvise to get yourself out of trouble. So this is the roly-poly dump bag made by Max Expedition that I carry. And as I said, I carry this pretty much all the time. And this is what we started collecting all our bits and pieces in. So, as you saw in the first video, we had a large piece of quartz that we found up on the hill. A type of sandstone, which is what you saw us sand flat on the stone in order to get a smooth edge. And then this is the clay type stone, which we used to make like a Nagura type stone when you're using Japanese water stones. You put water on the sandstone and you rub this onto it until you get like a slurry. And that's what you use to sharpen your stone or to put your very fine edge on. So three stones there, each one's a different hardness. But out of these three stones, he was able to improvise a knife sharpening kit. Now also on the video, we showed you Chris using his leather belt with the slurry from the Nagura stone to the back of his leather belt to use as a strop. But you can make a strop by using a fungus called birch polypore. It's a bracket fungus, grows on the side of birch trees, as the name suggests. And what I've done with this is the top of the polypore. And what I've done with this, I've actually cut it through, and when it's soft like this, or fresh, it's like a soft sponge. Chris described it as like a brie, which is a really good description actually. That's what it sort of looks like. It's like a brie type cheese. And what you need to do with this is you need to cut out the centre piece, you're looking for the centre core, and cut it as smooth as you possibly can. And then you need to dry it. Now in the possibles pouch, I've got two pieces here. So this whiter piece is what's come out the centre here. You can actually see the hole in the fungus here, and there's a hole in the strop just here. So it's come out the thickest part, which you can see here. Okay. And then you need to press it. You need to press it flat to get it as smooth as possible and get the moisture out of it. Now this one isn't completely dry yet, it's not bad, but it's still got a bit to go. Now I press this just in a vise with a couple of planks of wood. But out in the field, you could quite easily get a couple of pieces of flat rock and then put some heavy weight on top of it, or get yourselves a couple of bits of stick, carve them as flat as you can, and again press that between two bits of rock. But whatever happens, you need to press it flat and get the moisture out. And this dirtier one is one that is dried out now. Press exactly the same way as I just described. And you can see it's very, very smooth, very flat. And that will work excellent as a strop for your knife. Now, while we're on the topic of fungus, you can also get a tinder fungus. Now, this is horse's hoof fungus. And there's a large piece on there. Okay, horse's hoof fungus. Comes in a variety of shapes, sizes and colours, from white through to black, including greys and greens. What I'll do, I'll put a photo on here, showing you a range of sizes, shapes and colours. And all of the bracket fungus or horse's hoof fungus I'm going to show you in the photo were collected on... So with your horse's hoof fungus, if you can harvest it when it's still fresh, you should be able to cut it through with a knife. It will be tough going. If it's like this one now, which is dried out, you can hear how hard it is, you'll need something stronger, because a knife just won't go through it. And what you're looking to do is you want the outer layer of this fungus. So I've cut this through with a hacksaw, gives you an idea how hard it is. And then to use this, what you need to then do is, using the tip of your knife, is you just scratch up this fibres here until you get yourself a powder. And what I've put in this little tub here by mistake, but here's the powder I was referring to, and that's just literally the shavings off the top of this horse's hoof fungus. So just fluff up the end, basically just fluff up the surface. You don't actually make a powder. There is a small piece of horse's hoof, and just scratch the top, and what you're looking for is the fluff. Like that. And this stuff will take from a spark. It's very, very fibrous, very fine powder, and you can catch a spark on that fairly easily. Okay, so what else have we got in my pocket pouch? Well, again, there's some more pieces of horse's hoof fungus here. Again, these were harvested when it was fresh. And you can see the material you want. I'm going to have to zoom in for you a bit clearer. I'll come to the camera. Right, you can see on this piece, you've got a darker outer part and a darker inner part and a lighter outer part. And it's this lighter stuff that you're actually looking for. This stuff here is much softer. This inner part goes quite hard. This outer stuff is much softer and goes a lot more fluffy when you fluff it up. Okay? There's quite a good bit there. You can see this bit here where my finger is. It's really, when you touch it, it feels like velvet. Okay, so that's what you're looking for. You can see how thin these slithers are. It's literally the very outer edge you're looking for. Okay, so now what else have I got in my possibles pouch? Right, this is a piece of dried up deer poo. And we've experimented with this, and once you get this lit, it just smoulders and smoulders for ages. So this is another very good natural tinder. We also found dried sheep's poo, which did exactly the same. Once you get it going, it just smoulders and smoulders for ages. Oh, here we go. And here's some dried sheep's poo. Exactly the same, does exactly the same job. Now what else have I got in here? What this is dead heather. Obviously we was in Scotland and we was up on the moorlands and stuff, and heather is everywhere around you. And heather burns really, really well. But a cautionary note, acres and acres of moorland is destroyed by people being careless with heather. Now I know a lot of the environment agencies, they used to burn heather off as a natural control, but to be very, very careful. I mean, obviously a lot of places now they're looking to cut swathes in it rather than actually burn it, because it's more controllable. But if you're going to burn heather, make sure it's in an area not surrounded by other dead heather, because you can destroy acres of beautiful natural land. So dead heather. Now something else you can do with the birch polypore, you can make plasters from it. And pretty much the same as you do for making the strop, you take a very thin slice from the centre while it's still moist or fresh, and you can peel it and you can actually wrap it around your fingers. Makes excellent plasters, as I said, and field dressings. And if you want natural cordage, you can use nettle cordage or willow bark, some sort of natural fibre anyway outside, and just bind it with that. Right, well that was the contents of our improvised possibles pouch. We haven't done much in the way of a first aid kit, other than you could use a birch polypore for plasters, but I always carry a first aid kit with me anyway. There are substitutes you can use in the wilds. It's not really somewhere that I have much experience with, so it's not something I feel comfortable talking about. But I know there are certainly lots of people out there that do talk about, you know, natural painkillers, natural antihistamines, natural blood coagulants and things like that. But I'm sure if you do some research, you can find that out. But yeah, bit of ingenuity. Put your thinking caps on out there. And I'd like to see your ideas of improvised possibles pouches and things that you can utilise from the wild. I've kept this one pretty much just natural materials. As I said, you can use discarded rubbish. So, thanks guys, and I'll talk to you soon.